السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome back to watching Quran and Science. Now we move to Zabihullah Kareem to find out the meaning that he got from this holy verse.
Yeah, from this holy verse, I got that Allah is the creator of everything. From His signs is the moon, the sun, the earth, everything that we can see. And Allah says that don't worship all this. Worship the only creator of this, that Allah Almighty.
Abdurrahman.
For me, when I look at this verse, the thing that strikes my attention is how Allah moves the celestial bodies with this perfectness and preciseness. Mm-hmm. In itself is a miracle, I mean.
Yes, something that's constant in our lives and makes everything work.
Something that is beyond our imagination, how these celestial bodies move. Their very movement is very miraculous to me.
Yes. Okay. Professor Zaghloul, this surah Fussilat, it's the main perspective of it is about how the Holy Quran would be of guide to man, and it could also be healing to man. So do you think Quran really heals, and is it only psychological problems or more into health problems and so on?
I begin by thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and praising all His prophets and messengers and greeting you all in our Islamic way. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, blessings and mercy be with you all. The Quran by itself says, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَلَا يَزِيدُ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا خَسَارًا. So Allah is saying that this Quran that we are sending down to you is a cure by itself, not only for the psychological and moral and spiritual diseases, but even for the physical diseases. And this does not defy consulting medical doctors and going to them, because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is quoted to have said, "Ya ibad Allah tadawo, fa inna Allah ta'ala ma anzala da'an illa wa anzala ma'ahu ad-dawa." Yani, do try to get medicated, because Allah did not send down any disease without sending down with it the cure for it. So, despite the fact that we believe that reciting the Quran is a cure by itself to many of the human diseases, yet we are asked by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to consult the specialists in any disease we may suffer, and at the same time we can use the Quran. And that's why I attended a conference in Abu Dhabi many months ago, and it was medication by the Quran. And we came to the conclusion that it's high time to have within every hospital and within every clinic the professional medical doctor, and at the same time the professional curer by the Quran. Yes. And we can have them side by side. And by this we can really assure every person, every ill person, that we are doing our best using the medication which man has achieved through experimentation and observation, and at the same time we're using the blessings of the Quran as the advice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as the advice of the Quran itself.
So it is true that certain verses of the Holy Quran could be shifa'un lil-mu'minin or healing for but at the same time you mentioned that you have to seek the professional help.
Yes, what I'm saying is that man is not this body alone. Man is a spiritual aspect as well as a physical aspect. And in as much as the physical aspect needs the acquired knowledge of man, the spiritual aspect of man needs the healing of the Quran and the healing of the advices of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So I think an Islamic hospital or an Islamic clinic must join both ways of treatment, not just relying on one, leaving the other completely or neglecting it completely.
And what is the appropriate way, Islamic way, of using Quran? Because some people, they read Quran over water and they use this. What is the appropriate and the right way of using Quran to heal people?
You see, the right way is what the Prophet did, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He used to use al-ruqya, al-shara'iyya, yani healing by the Quran in the way he has prescribed. And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you can read within your own palms, the two hands. You can read Al-Fatiha, Ayat Al-Kursi, the three last verses in Surah Al-Baqarah, the three last verses in Surah Al-Hashr. This is once. And then Al-Kafirun, قل هو الله أحد, قل أعوذ برب الفلق, قل أعوذ برب الناس, three times. And you blow in your hand and rub your body with it.
I'd ask you to repeat this again for our viewers. Okay. This is very important.
The الرقية الشرعية, as the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم has prescribed for us, and to read within your own hands,
yes,
yourself, فاتحة الكتاب,
فاتحة,
آية الكرسي, the three last verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, the three last verses of Surah Al-Hashr, and then this is once.
Okay.
And then Al-Kafirun three times, Samadiyya three times, Al-Falaq three times, and An-Nas three times. And then you blow in your hand and rub your body completely. And the Prophet used to do this every night and every morning, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because this can be a healing for certain aspects of the human diseases that cannot be treated by the proper medication gained by man.
Yes, and is it correct also to be doing this for someone else, like you reading and then blowing?
But the best thing is that you can do it for yourself, and you can do it if people can trust you. You can do it for others.
Yes, because some people
but
say
do
like
it for
sheikh
man. Don't
or
do
something.
It for money. Yeah.
Of course not.
Yes, don't do it for money.
Some people say like sheikh or something. It would be a blessing from him because he's a man of religion.
Wallahi, akhi, you see, it's the sincerity in the person who is doing it that can be the result. You see, the result.
Okay.
And here I would like to mention something which I may take us out of the context of the verse because you opened that challenge for us. There is a study by a Japanese professor on water. And I have read his book, and I have written an introduction for the Arabic translation of it. The book is called A Message from Water. And he said 15 years of experience has proved to him that water, this fluid, a liquid, has got a feeling, a memory, a reaction to what is read on it or what's said to it. So much so that once you freeze this water that was subjected to recitation of the Quran or addressing it in a nice way, it can give a crystal form completely different from another a sample of water. So I here remember the verse in the Quran which says, تُسَبِّحُ لَهُ السَّمَاوَاتُ السَّبْعُ وَالْأَرْضُ وَمَنْ فِيهِنَّ وَإِنْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ إِلَّا يُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِهِ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَفْقَهُونَ تَسْبِيحَهُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ حَلِيمًا غَفُورًا. And in brief, nothing in this universe is not worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything in that universe is worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Matter, energy, water, fluids, solids, gases, plants, animals, except the unbelievers between men and jinn, because these are free-willed beings, you see.
Yes.
So everything in that universe is worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you address anything with a Quranic verse or with a saying of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's bound to be affected by that.
Yes.
And that's why every word you utter to a glass of water, once you crystallize it, it will give a different crystal form. And this man said that the best crystal form he ever had was the water with a writing on it, Bismillah. And he writes in his book, I don't know what Bismillah is, but the best image I had for a crystal, a water crystal or an ice crystal, is from the water that we wrote on it, Bismillah.
Subhanallah. Okay, and the reason I started with this is to find out the relation between this guide, this guide from the Holy Quran to human, and the alternation of day and night.
Yes.
In the verse, it was mentioned Alayl wa Nahar wa al-Shams wa al-Qamar. And we've mentioned in earlier episodes about that the Islamic day starts with the night.
Yes. Actually,
it does not start with.
You see, of course, without the alternation of night and day, life could have never existed on the surface of that planet. None of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at least the living beings, you see, can exist within sunshine 24 hours or night 24 hours. Many of the biological processes in plants, animals, in humans, change from daytime to nighttime, or from nighttime to daytime. Many of the biological activities, you see, the enzymes that are secreted, hormones that are secreted vary from day to night. Even the activity of the plants, they take during daytime carbon dioxide and release oxygen, and at nighttime they take oxygen and release carbon dioxide. Mm-hmm. So without the alternation of day and night, life on the surface of that planet would have been virtually impossible.
Yeah. Okay. Now we move to a very short break and we return back, so stay tuned. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back. You're watching Quran and Science, and this episode is all about the alternation of day and night. We've discussed also previously in the first segment more about how the Holy Quran is a guide and could be healing to human. Now, I move now to questions by Zabihullah Kareem.
Okay, Professor, my question is that if we see in this verse Allah mentioned that He's saying, starting with, don't worship the sun, the moon, the day and night. But we have still people are worshiping these kinds. What makes them worship them? Recalling that there was even Ibrahim alayhi salam when he was young, when he started looking for his God, he said that moon is my God. But after he changed. But what makes them still now that people are...
You see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has implanted in the inner nature of man the love of worshipping Him. The Quran reads, وَإِذْ أَخْذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَأَشْهَدَهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ شَهِدْنَا أَنْ تَقُولُوا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ إِنَّا كُنَّا عَنْ هَذَا غَافِلِينَ. So Allah has implanted in the inner nature of man the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That man has got a Lord who has created him and who has created everything in that universe, and he is bound to worship that creator, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if man is not guided to the proper creator, there is this innate need in his body to worship. If he does not know the right creator to worship him, he will worship anything. He can worship himself, he can worship others, he can worship a tree, a star, a little baby, the moon, the sun, can worship anything to satisfy this innate need in him. And that's why we have people today who worship Satan, worship the shaitan. And could anybody with any sense worship the shaitan? Could anybody having a pinch of salt of reason to worship the shaitan? But this is the work of the shaitan, the deviation of man, part of the human deviation.
But I believe that... If some people are worshipping Satan, maybe they did not get that close to the Islamic or to the Christian community.
But at least, you see, worshipping the Shaytan is the biggest deviation any human being can think of, you see. Even worshipping a tree may be acceptable, you see, than worshipping the Shaytan.
Yeah.
It's all deviations and all kufr, blaspheming. A complete blasphemy, you see, going out of the way. But at least to worship the shaitan, who is the determined enemy of man, is something beyond any imagination. So if somebody worship the moon or the sun, again, part of that human deviation.
And I believe that maybe shaitan is a part of in this worship, because he inspired the mind of this person to worship the sun and the moon.
Most of the... forms of shirk or kufr or other deviations, you come through the work of the shaitan, who try to drift man away from the true belief.
Yeah. Okay, moving to Abdurrahman.
There is something in this verse that is very special to me. Why Allah, not only in this verse actually, Allah always talks about the moon and the sun,
yes.
Not the earth and the moon or...
Yes.
Why the moon and the sun together, yes. Always?
You see, because first of all, the creation of the sun as a star is a miracle by itself. As we mentioned in the previous episode, any star is an agglomeration of gas. And this agglomeration of gas, Allah compresses and causes vertigos to go within. And these vertigos can force the nuclei of hydrogen to fuse together to produce helium, and then energy is released. Helium fused together to produce lithium, and energy is produced. So actually, these stars, including the sun, is a universal nuclear reactor, a gigantic nuclear reactor where Allah is creating all the elements needed for the stability of that universe to be formed. So stars are among the greatest creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The nearest star to us is the sun. So he's always directing our attention to the beauty in the creation of the sun. Without the sun, this earth could have never existed because we revolve around the sun. We are governed by the gravitational force of the sun. So without the sun, this planet could have never been there. The moon, again, is the nearest heavenly body to the earth. And the moon plays a very, very important role in making this earth inhabitable as well. The tidal currents are mainly created by the moon. The light during night time comes through the reflection of the sun rays on the moon's surface. So much so that if the moon is lost, you see, the moon is drifting away from us these days at the rate of 3 to 4 centimeters per year. And this means that the moon will be swallowed by the sun because it's drifting away from us towards the sun. And logic would say that time will come when the sun will swallow the moon. And the Quran has said this 14 centuries ago, وَجُمِعَ الشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرُ. And this is the very first step in the destruction of the universe. Because once this happens, the earth will be completely disturbed. The moon plays a very, very important role in the stability of the earth. So if the moon is swallowed by the sun, this will be the very first beginning of the destruction of that universe. And that's why the Quran is persistently directing our attention towards the importance of the creation of the sun and the moon, which both of them can testify to the wisdom, knowledge, and might and power of the Creator.
Dr. Zaghlouli, you mentioned stars and planets and moons. Does this mean that a moon is not a planet?
The moon is a satellite to a planet. You see, the star is a different entity. As I said, it's an agglomeration of gases wherein the process of nuclear fusion starts. Once this happens, this agglomeration of gas becomes a star. But the planet is a cold surface, a cold body. And a satellite is a small body revolving around the planet. So we have these classifications. We have stars, we have planets, we have satellites to the planets, which are the moons.
Okay. Now, I have a very important question regarding this topic. It's within another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَجَعَلْنَا اللَّيْلَ لَبَاسًا وَجَعَلْنَا النَّهَارَ مَعَاشًا.
نعم.
So, what would be the bad effects of if a human is sleeping in the morning and waking up at night?
Definitely.
What is the bad implication?
Definitely. You see, it has been physically proved that the best hours for working are the daytime hours. And the best hours for sleeping are the early days of the night. Early hours of the night, okay. The early hours of the night. So much so that they call this, before midnight, they call this the beauty sleep. It's the sleep that gives the human body the maximum amount of rest it may need. And I have an explanation for this, because during the daytime, we get the expansion of the different zones which Allah has created for the protection of life on earth. Yes. So you can move around on the surface of the earth safely and happily without any danger of any cosmic particles coming down to hit you or some of the natural disasters that usually take place.
And as you mentioned in the previous episodes, that the dangers of these rays are more at night, more than the morning.
Definitely. That's okay. What I was coming to or heading at. At night, these zones shrink quite a lot. And that's why the danger is massive. Not only this, but as we said also in another episode, the physiology of the human body, it changes at night. You see, then its activity during the day. During daytime, we have certain hormones that are being produced that enhance all the organs of the body to be wide awake and ready for work and ready for activation. during nighttime, we have certain hormones and certain enzymes that instruct all the organs of the body to relax and actually go to sleep. So if you reverse this process as if you are going against the natural process Allah has created the human body with. And that's why Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is quoted to have said that he never stayed awake after Isha prayer, unless there is a need for that. He used to go to bed immediately after Isha prayer so that he can wake up before Fajr, perform this night prayer at Tahajjud, and then be ready and fresh for Fajr prayer.
So why come the usual life that we're living now, you don't find people really sleeping after Isha?
And they tend to be... This is again part of the disturbance.
And part of the culture, I guess, also. It's something against the culture.
You see, we have been seriously affected by many of the Western cultures and many of our own bad habits as well, mm-hmm. because many of the Westerners don't really stay awake all night.
Exactly. But I think they're now, in the West now, they are sleeping early and they're waking early.
So. Yes, because they found by experimentation that this is the best way they can live with. But they don't do it out of religious reasons, you see.
Do it for
they
health.
Do it about health. Utility. Yes. Mm-hmm. It's the best way of they can use it. Mm-hmm. But if you imagine that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam advised us to go to bed as early as you can, and don't stay awake unless there is a need. Examination or travel or receiving some visitors coming from abroad or preparing for jihad, something like that. Yes. But in a normal day, it's much better for you to sleep after Isha prayer so that you can wake up before Fajr. And the Prophet said, the best thing a believer can do are two rak'ahs before the Fajr prayer in the middle of the night. Mm-hmm. This is the best activity you can ever achieve. Yes. So if you go to bed early, you can wake up fresh before Fajr prayer. You can perform your night prayer, as the Prophet explained, or Tahajjud. And then you can again go to Fajr prayer fresh. And you can start your day early. And you can get many blessings of the hours of the day. See, the day actually spread in front of you. Mm-hmm. You can use it as much as you like. Mm-hmm. But if you stay late at night and get out of bed after sunrise, you see,
Sayyidah Aisha,
yes. said that, wallahi, I'm worried how those people who pray Salatul Subh after sunrise, how they get provisions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the Ajab al Musad Subh, Ba'da Tulu'a Shams, Kayfa Yarzuqhu Allah.
Yes.
So, really, it's much better for a Muslim to conform to the regime the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has established for us. Go to bed early and get up really early so that you can see the day extended in front of you. You can use it as much as you can.
What about the daytime nap? One final question.
The daytime
nap, you know, nap. When you're sleeping.
The Prophet used to do it,
yes.
sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Awesome.
Because again, we mentioned in another episode that the organs of the human body need a certain time for relaxation, for rebuilding what cells have been destroyed, reconnecting the nervous system. Because the weakest point in the human body are the connections between the nerve cells. And that's why, if you stay awake for quite a long time, the most seriously affected part of your body is your brain. And you feel strained and you immediately need to go to bed. So this afternoon nap, after lunch or after Salatul Dhuhr, the noon prayer, is a way of regenerating your body and recharging your body. It's not a long lapse of time. It can be only a few minutes, actually.
Yes.
Just to relax and get ready for another activity.
Right. Thank you very much, Doctor, for being here with us. It was very informative.
Barakallah fi.
And I also thank Abdurrahman Ismail and Zabihullah Kareem for being here with us.
Thanks a lot.
This, my dear brothers, we come to the end of this episode of Quran and Science. See you in the coming edition. Thanks for watching. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.